God, I thank you that God, I thank you, Jesus, that as we worship, you were moving. As we sang, you were moving. As we lifted our hands, you were shifting things. Hallelujah! We give you praise for it. Have your way in this place. God, we stand in expectation of an amazing word that's going to shift our lives forever. Thank you for what you've done. Thank you that, God, we are no longer slaves to fear. Fear is a spirit, and that did not come from you. So we rebuke and we reject that thing that did not come from you. And we receive your peace, your love, your joy, and your strength. These things we ask and we thank you for in the mighty and powerful, incredible name of Jesus. Let his sons and daughters clap your hands and say, amen in this place. I need somebody to take 20 seconds if you know that God is doing something in your life to just give him a God, I thank you, God, for praise. Real quick, we gotta go. But just thank him for what he's already done. I want you to go hug three people and tell them, say, I'm no longer a slave to fear. Tell them. Hug three people, find them, hug them real tight. Say, I'm no longer a slave to fear, but I'm a child of God.
For being here in his house one more time. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to open up with prayer. Amen. Lord, we come before you in the name of Jesus. We thank you and we praise you for this day, for this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. We thank you and we praise you, Father God, for waking us up to let us see another day.
Yes.
We're looking forward to the Lord having his way in the house. We bind every spirit that is contrary to the Spirit of God. Lord, we say, have your way this day in the name of Jesus. Move by your spirit, Lord. We ask that you bring the minds in the name of Jesus. We ask that you touch the baby in the name of Jesus and bring a hush on them in the name of Jesus. Let us be able to hear what thus saith the Lord. We ask that you move upon everybody that has a part in this service today in the name of Jesus. We bind every demon, every demonic spirit, every spirit that is contrary to the Spirit of God. We curse it right now from the root and we send it back to the pits of hell from whence it came. And we say, have your way. In the name of Jesus, in Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
I'm going to do a scripture reading, Psalms 91. Dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him I will trust. Surely he shall deliver you from the snare and from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. He shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you shall take refuge. This is a different Bible. He shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you shall take refuge. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day, nor of the pestilence that walk in darkness, nor of the destruction that lays waste at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side, and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. Only with your eyes shall you look and see the reward of the wicked. Because you have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, your dwelling place, no evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwelling, for he shall give his angels charge over you, to keep you in all your ways. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You shall tread upon the lion and the cobra. The young lion and the serpent shall you trample under feet. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore I will deliver him. I will set him on high because he has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. And I will be with him in trouble, and I will deliver him and honor him with long life. I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. We thank the Lord for the blessing reading of his word. Amen.
Amen.
That's just the New King James Version. Amen. It's all right. Amen. And at this time, we're going to...
What's the best thing?
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank you,
Lord. Hallelujah. God is good.
Yes.
Not sometimes, but all the time.
Amen.
No matter what's going on, no matter what's happening,
yes.
He's still good.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
This is the thought of the day. And the Holy Spirit's been dealing with me about peace. Not just any kind of peace, but the Bible talks about a peace that passes all understanding.
Amen.
Only a peace that Jesus can give you. No other peace but what he gives you. To get you through no matter what you're going through.
Amen.
But it can get you through a lot.
Amen.
And he brought me back to the storm. You know, one thing we have to be careful as believers is how we talk when we're going through stuff.
Yes, that's right.
And when our minds are going through a lot and the storm is raging, we tend to say things that doesn't help the situation.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Well,
and God, you know, God brought me back to when Jesus was in the midst of the storm. And the storm was raging all around him, and the disciples were sitting in the boat, and he was tossing the boat all crazy, and they're sitting there, and they don't know what to do, and everything's chaotic. In their minds, there was nothing that they could do to bring this storm under control.
Mm-hmm.
It was beyond their ability to be able to cause the storm to cease, but Jesus was there. He knew exactly what to do.
Mm-hmm.
And he woke up and he spoke to the storm and he said, "Peace, be still." And as he spoke to the storm and he told the storm to be still, the storm came quiet. And everything calmed down. So the God wanted me to understand that you can't go through anything without peace.
Amen.
Yes.
You have to call upon the peace of God to be able to walk through your situations.
Yes.
God sometimes has to calm you down so he can speak to you. Because
yes.
You can't hear God if there's so much chaos in your mind, if there's so much chaos in your soul, if there's so much chaos around you. You can't hear God. But sometimes God got to bring you to a stillness so he can speak to you. And then he starts to fill you. And he fills you with faith. And he builds you up. So you're able to speak to your situation. But when you speak to your situation, you speak for it to operate how God wants you to operate. How he wants it to operate.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Speaking faith to the situation.
Yes.
So as I end the thought of the day, speak to your situation.
Oh, yes.
Using faith as Jesus spoke to the storm. And walk in peace. Allow the peace to guide you. As you walk through your situation.
Amen.
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 Spirit being in this place. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. At this time, we're going to have testimony. You know, just talking about the goodness of the Lord. We don't want to get so comfortable that we say, oh, I don't have a testimony. I don't have anything to say. Well, he woke you up. So at this time, we're going to give some testimonies, followed by the children singing every praise, you know, and then the solo.
Psalm 91, verse 15 says, he shall call upon the name, he shall call upon me, and I will answer him, and I will be with him in trouble. Amen. And I will honor him. I will deliver him and honor him. Mm-hmm. I will be with him in trouble. Mm-hmm. I was in trouble this week. Mm-hmm. Unexpected trouble. I give honor and praise to the Lord for answering prayer through that trouble. And I thank the Lord that I could call upon him. I called my pastor right away. She rallied the people of God and the children of God,
yes,
and they prayed.
Yes, amen.
And God answered.
Thank you, Lord.
God answered. And what happened was I foolishly... I own it all, made the mistake of going to my email, just clearing it off, trying to clear out my email. And I saw an email from the Geek Squad, and I had experience with them in the past through Dell and HB and all that. So I thought it was okay to contact them. They said, call this number. They were charging me for something that I didn't want. Anyway, I made the mistake of calling them. And I made the dumb mistake of allowing the person, the so-called Geek Squad technician, who was a fraud, a hold of my computer. I gave him remote control. That was a big mistake. And when I realized it had happened, I was like, oh, no, I'm in trouble. Because once they get a hold of your stuff. They can block the screen. They can lock you out. I mean, he was doing all of that. And I was like, Jesus. And then I called Pastor Brenda.
Uh-huh.
And even while I had him on the phone, I got her on the phone. And he said, who are you calling? I just called Pastor Brenda. And I said, pray. And then I hung up the phone. I didn't even tell you. Did I tell you? I just said I was panicked. I was in a panic mode. And then I called the police. And the police came. And this guy, he's still on the phone. The man, I said, you know what, you're a scammer now. You're bullying me. I know what you're about.
Uh-huh.
But he had control. And I couldn't do anything. I was in trouble.
Yeah.
And he got into my account. And he showed me the account, all accounts. And then there were zeros. I was like, oh,
Jesus.
Lord, Preston's going to kill me.
What?
Oh, no, I'm in big trouble. So the police came, and it was just one awesome young man. I call him Apostle Paul because his name was Paul. He was such a nice officer. He stayed with me the whole time.
Uh-huh.
He stayed with me 3 hours. He rebooted my computer,
uh-huh.
and... you know, guided me through the whole process. I was like nervous as all get out. And he was just so calm and just so reassuring and kind and loving. And I know he was sent from God.
Yes. Amen.
You are sent from God. I never heard of anybody say staying for 3 hours, 3 whole hours. And he's just, we talked and, you know, he was really trying to help me to calm down. He could tell I was nervous, although I was trying to be cool. But I wasn't. Oh, it was awful. And so, at any rate, he managed to help my computer and all of that. So I had to get started all over again. I lost everything on my computer. But that's okay. I can, restore that.
Uh-huh.
But I called the bank, and they shut my accounts down. And they moved money.
Okay.
They moved money. And they opened up that so-called Zelle account my account. So they were moving money in my husband's account. He has a greater account. And I was like, oh, Lord, I'm in trouble. But the Holy Spirit was there the whole time.
Amen.
Helping me. I mean, every fiber in my body was trembling.
Oh. Yes.
It was. It was I couldn't control it. I was standing still, but I was like trembling on the inside.
Yeah.
And it was like, I had never experienced anything like that before, when you're out of control, when you don't have any control over anything. Somebody else has control over you. It was an assault. It really was.
Mm-hmm.
It was a cyber assault. So I understand how a person feels when they're assaulted by the enemy, whether in the natural or in the spirit. It doesn't feel good. And like Minister Mike said, he said, "You, no matter what you're going through, you know, you have to call on the peace of God. He has to calm the storm."
Uh-huh. Amen.
And he was calming the storm, even though I was like inside raging.
Well.
Mm-hmm.
But Jesus was calming the storm, and it took 3 hours to get that resolved. And then I had to go to the bank, and a lot of things I had to do after that.
Uh-huh.
And still do.
Mm-hmm.
And still doing, because they can wreck your life.
Yes, they can. Yes.
They can wreck your life from an arm, just from a chair. They can wreck your life. So my advice to anybody, you see something on your email doesn't look right, delete it right away. Don't even touch any buttons of any kind. Delete it.
Uh-huh.
Something that's, because they can come from reputable avenues, which you think might be reputable, they're not.
Yeah.
They'll come through any kind of agency that you might be working with. No, delete it right away and call the company and say, "Did you send me?" And they'll say, "No, we didn't do that."
Mm-hmm.
So it was just a big alert for me.
Well,
but the Lord really helped me tremendously. And he kept sending people in to help me with biblical names like Rebecca. And Michael, the archangel.
Yeah.
And I was like, "Wow, God, you're reminding me that you are there in the midst." And so that is my testimony, is that the Lord helped me in the middle of the storm to get through, and nothing was lost.
Oh, praise God.
And that was God. It was God. And even the next day, I saw that even though my computer was all cleared off and new and fresh, they had still done something to one of my accounts.
Mm.
And so I had to call the bank and shut that one down too.
Yeah.
So I don't know. These people are crafty.
Yeah.
And they're smart. Yeah. And I had talked to my sister in San Jose, and she said, it's a big, big thing in India. These people are working $10 a day to do this, to put food on their table.
Oh.
But it's illegal.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
they don't care. They're trying to just make food. Provide for their family.
Yes,
so
yes.
So the people who do these things are taking advantage of them as well. So my prayer is that, Lord, help us.
Yes.
Save us and save them as well.
Yes.
You know, but I thank God that, and I'm sorry I didn't mean to be so long.
Right. Oh, so
but yeah, it's serious out there.
Yeah.
And then I was reading, one more thing. I was reading one of my little devotionals, it said, "Put on the whole armor of God in the evil day."
Yeah.
Or in the evil day. We're in the evil
day. Amen.
We're in it. Mm-hmm. Everywhere you look, we're in it.
Mm-hmm.
So, people of God, armor yourself up. Be vigilant. Be alert. Be sober. Walk with God. Love with God. Love God. And walk with Him. Love your neighbor as you love yourself.
Amen.
Amen. Any more testimonies? No more testimonies. I'm going to give what while Pastor Adrian was talking, the Lord had gave me. He said, "We give the enemy too much control over our life."
Mm-hmm.
Yes. He's a bully, and he's bullying a lot of people.
Yeah.
We have the power. God has given us the power over the enemy, but we allow the enemy to bully us, and he has came in and taken over a lot of people's lives because we just let him bully us.
Yes.
You know, the power is in your hands. He's given us power. When he died on the cross, he said, "I go now, and I give you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions," right?
Yeah.
Yes. But we don't use our power, you know? You got to take your power back. God gave it to you.
Amen.
Use it.
Amen.
If not, the devil going to take everything you got.
Amen.
Yes.
The devil is a liar.
He's a liar. Yeah. And a deceiver, too.
Amen.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Every praise.
Amen.
There you go.
Amen.
Give it to Maria. my Redeemer.
This is a Tempur-Pedic.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah, praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Our Redeemer lives. It is my great honor and joy to introduce to you the woman of God who will be bringing the word of the Lord to us today. Minister Flowina received the Lord Jesus Christ at the age of 7.
Oh. Thank you, Lord.
She loves the Lord with all of her heart.
Yes.
And she followed the Lord through all of her stages and phases of her young life.
Uh-huh.
She is compassionate, loving, and kind.
Amen.
Her love for the Lord is demonstrated as she shares that love with the lost and gives encouragement to believers and to her family, to young people and children. She is a missionary at heart, an evangelist, a teacher, a preacher, and a worshiping warrior.
Amen.
Well,
she loves to pray. And for 5 years, faithfully, she hosted online and on the phone, Daughters of the King prayer line for 5 years. She did that faithfully.
Oh, bless you.
She loves the Lord. She loves the Word of God. And when she lived in, and she's a woman of the Word. When she lived in Atlanta, she attended Charis Bible College under Andrew Warmack. Mm-hmm. Minister Flowina faithfully follows the call of God on her life. And in her walk with God, in all that she does, her desire is to please the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
I present to you my daughter and the daughter of the King,
yeah.
Minister Flowina.
God, you all. My mom made me smile. Can we just thank God for everything? Thank God for Pastor Adrian and Pastor Brenda, Pastor Denny Jones, my pastors here. I love you all. I thank God for Jesus. As my dear sister in Christ, Minister Sandy, was singing, I was just being so blessed by I Know My Redeemer Lives.
Yes.
I was just sitting there thinking about, wow, I'm so grateful for you, Lord. And just what you've done over the years in my life, just walking with you and your faithfulness. And as she's saying, I know my Redeemer lives, it just blessed me so personally. So thank you, my sister. Thank you for that. And for the children, God bless them for their awesome worship. And I thank God for Jesus, the way ministries. You know, I was, a lot happened from last week to this week, Pastor Brenda. And I did have some testimonies, but I want to tell you all first that God is good.
Amen.
I should take it off. God is really good. And I haven't done this in a while, but I thank God just for the opportunity to be here. And about a week ago, I'm going to share with you guys a dream that the Father gave me, the Lord gave me about a week ago. It's how he brought me to what I would be sharing about, actually. About a week ago, I woke up and I had this dream. And in the dream, it's like I was walking down a pavement. And this pavement, it was just like, you know, just a concrete black pavement. And I was with some friends of mine from high school who are still some of my dearest best sister friends. And we're walking down the pavement. And the way we're dressed, it reminds me of what we used to do 25 years ago, Kennywood Picnic. And we're walking down, and there's all these people. It's a wide outdoor auditorium. All these people seated, it's packed. But we're walking down like we're kind of like in a, walking through an amusement park, but it's just a wide, it's almost as if we were in a cathedral, but there were no walls, and there's just seats everywhere, and it's all these people. And as we're walking down, somehow they got way ahead of me, and I remember my foot kind of just slid outside of my sandal. And you know, back in the day, they always would be like, "Slow, flow is slow." So I'm way in the back; they're way up front, you guys, and my sandal's coming off my foot, and they're like, "Oh, let's turn around and wait for flow." I love my best friends from high school, and so anyway, so they're waiting for me, and while they're waiting for me, in comes this caravan of another one of my best sister friends, but this time it's her whole family, and it looks like, you know, like an SUV with the doors blown out, and the whole family's in it, and they're zooming past, and I'm like, oh, there they go, I said, they got a boatload,
yeah.
So now it's like all these people coming in, and as we continue to walk,
we can't find a seat anywhere. So we continue to walk, and it's like we're walking down to the front of a sanctuary, but we turn the corner and we begin to walk like around, like as if you were walking down the front of a sanctuary, and then you begin to turn and just walk around until you can find seating. Well, I saw people in the far back corner going up these steps. It's like, okay, we want to sit in the balcony. So on our way to the balcony, the group I was with decided, no, we're going to the candy store. So they go to the candy store and get some ice cream, and I see my aunt in the candy store. So I'm like, so we don't make it to the balcony. But then as I woke up, I heard the Holy Spirit reveal to me, don't miss heaven. Mm-hmm. So what the Lord was showing me, you guys, was a picture of my friends and family in heaven. Mm-hmm. And what he was showing me, my good friends that I saw who came in on that SUV with the doors blown out, and it was like 30 people, he showed me their whole family came in. Mm-hmm. And I said, wow. I still haven't even told her this testimony. Their whole family came in. And he was just showing me the sweetness and the goodness of heaven. That's why there was a candy shop. Mm-hmm. That's why we had to go to the back balcony, because it was packed. Mm-hmm. It was so packed. It was so many people. But it was the goodness of God, and it was the sweetness of God, because we're rolling in like we're going to Kennywood.
Yeah.
Now, God was giving me a picture of something, you guys. Yeah. This is not exactly what heaven looks like, I believe. But he was showing me it's packed. Mm-hmm. And he was saying, you don't want to miss it.
Yeah. Amen. Don't
miss it. Amen. You don't want to miss it. So there were other things that happened last week, but he was just showing me. I said, wow, that's so deep, Father. He said, this is, you don't want to miss this. There's so many good things I have in my kingdom for my children. You don't want to miss it. Mm-hmm. I said, wow, God. I said, that was beautiful. Amen. And as the week went on, he began to show me through that dream, or maybe it was later on that morning, he said, set your eyes on things above. Mm-hmm. Set your eyes on things above. And I had to search that out. I had to search that out. Minister Mike, and say, well, where is that scripture? And he took me to, you guys, if you turn with me, Colossians. Colossians is where it talks about setting your eyes on things above. And I just want to speak, not for long, for real, for real, you guys, but just to talk about setting your eyes on things above and the things that we come against in life, believers and unbelievers, that stop us from setting our eyes on things above. Mm-hmm. Amen. 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 If you turn with me to Colossians chapter 3, it says in verse 2, I'll read 1 through 3. I'm reading from the New King James Version. If then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God, setting your mind on things above, not on things of the earth. Mm-hmm. For you died, and your life is hidden in Christ with God. Set your mind on things above. What does it mean to fix your mind on things above, not on earthly things? You know, God knows that we all have responsibilities, and we all have loads that we have to bear. We all have children, we all have jobs, we have bills, things that we have to face. But then as I began to think about, well, what are you saying? Set our minds on things above. What is important about this? How do we do that practically, Father? He brought me another scripture. And this scripture comes from, it's in Matthew, it's also in Mark, but it's about the cares of this world. Mm. And Minister Mike, he set us up beautifully this morning with his thought for the day, because he said, listen, we need the peace of God.
Yes.
We need the peace of God. And you know, the peace of God, the cares of this world, if you don't know it, can be an enemy to the peace of God.
Yes.
So really, I want you to look at Colossians, but for real, on our way to setting our mind on things above, we gotta understand the culprit, what gets in our way. Mm-hmm. And it's one of the things that the Holy Spirit revealed to me is it's the cares of this world. Mm-hmm. And I'm gonna read to you guys I'm gonna read from the New King James, and also share a little bit more from, it's called the Expanded Bible, just to give you guys a picture as we talk about, that's really where I'm gonna linger and hang out today, the cares of this world. What's going on in life that prevents us from experiencing all that God has for us? What's going on that's keeping us from, you know, really walking in the fullness of what he has? That's what he showed me. hinders us so many times. But it says in Matthew 13, if you want to take a second and go there, if you're on your phone, if you have a physical Bible, Matthew 13, verses 22. Now he who receives seed among the thorns is he who hears the word, and the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of the riches choke the word, and he becomes unfruitful. You know, I don't want to park there too much about unfruitfulness or park there about he who receives the word. That parable, you know, Jesus was really teaching about how when the word is sown onto our hearts, you know, you can hear it, and it can like quickly fall away,
yeah.
Or you can receive it. Uh-huh. That's what that, if you really want to dig into it in Matthew 13. And so he's just setting us up to say, you know what, when the word comes, the word is the seed, and there are thorns and bristles and things that can get in the way from you receiving, from you hearing.
Yeah.
So God is saying, listen, but when I give you my word, when I give you an instruction, when I give you help for life through my manual called the Word of God, there are things that are going to come to try to steal it.
Yeah.
There are things that are going to come to try to block you from receiving from me. So he said one of them is the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of the riches that choke the word, and you and I become unfruitful in life. And I said, God, if the important piece that you want me to share with my friends and my family today, I said, what are the cares of this world? We could just think about our lives. You know, we could think about just the things that are on our minds right now that are, you know, phones, you know,
yes,
people
yes.
still texting us while we're here.
Yes.
Just the things that happened this morning to distract us from getting here. Yes. The things that we know we
yes.
have to do when service is over.
Yes.
You know, the responsibilities we have Monday through Saturday until we get here. All the things that we have to do. And
yes.
there's a website, you guys. I said, Lord, help me break this down. Cares of this world. I don't want to rush through this.
Mm-hmm.
And I went to this website. It's called Salvation Call. And very, very interesting article, an in-depth article, but they list, I'm going to read some of the things that they say, but I want you guys to think about the things for you that are the cares of this world. Personally, what are the things that are cares for this world, of this world to you? But they note here the pursuit of your career,
mm-hmm.
your education, your aims, your goals, your ambitions, material things such as your houses, your cars, your clothes, your money, necessities, you know, provision is so big, our money. You know, do I have enough to meet our needs?
Mm-hmm.
Medical care, home, clothes, are we going through in our body? What are the things that are on our minds the most? What are the things that we're thinking about more than anything else? One's responsibilities or duties to pay medical bills, school fees, domestic bills, relationship matters. Many of us are married, job security, financial security. And he even went into more about that. But I began to think about it, and the Lord began to show me something through something that happened also to me this week. And he told me that the cares of this world are preventing us from walking out the fullness of his plan and from hindering us from receiving more of the Lord.
Well,
I said, God, wow. He just gave me a few key points, and he just told me not to rush because I don't know what, you know, he's saying to you personally, but he had to show me, Flo, in your rushing, slow down,
well,
because you're going to miss me.
Yeah, uh-huh.
I lost my keys, you guys.
Yeah,
this
that.
Happened last
Come
week.
Now. That.
I lost my
Preach
keys.
It.
Oh, yeah.
And
hey.
I lost my keys, and I'm silly. I'm like a big kid, you know. And so I was leaving my good friend's house, my neighbor, and I'm just playing in the snow. Well, I dropped my by myself and left her house. But I'm playing in the snow. This was like, you know, we had this, you know, blizzard on the East Coast, and
right,
so there's
right.
all this snow. And I leave her house, and I'm just like throwing snow in the air, and it's late at night. And I only have to go across the street to get home, and so I'm thinking I'm good. But I get across, and I get home, and I say, wait a minute. I think I lost my keys. The Holy Spirit says, backtrack your steps. Now, this was happening like on a Friday night, so not today's Sunday, so not last Friday. Friday before last, over a week ago. And I leave her house, and I just heard him say, backtrack your steps. But then I did that. I didn't see him. It's cold. It's late at night. It's Friday night, and I don't see him anywhere, but I saw my footprints, but I said, you know what, I'm doing like this, I'm moving my foot, my boots in the snow to try to see, did I drop them, where did they, I would have heard them, I would have seen, no, you're not going to, snow is kind of light and kind of soft, you know, I didn't hear any keys falling, so.
Uh-huh.
So then I kept thinking, well, maybe they were inside, maybe I didn't, I know I took them outside because I locked my door to get to her house, but where were they? Well, because of this, I couldn't drive my car.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you, Pastor Mom let me drive her car, but I couldn't drive my car. So for 3 days, I couldn't find my keys. And I really, really, you guys, I wasn't worried, but I knew that, okay, Lord, you got to tell me what's up, because if I don't find these keys, you know, I'm not going to be able to go anywhere, and I got to get this car fixed because this car needs work on it. And so I'm like, I can't even drive to go get it fixed. So it's just, the car is just grounded. And I heard the Lord say it's grounded for a reason, like he was letting me know, your car is not moving right now. But and all I knew that it was that he's going to show me why. That's all I knew. The last time that happened, and my car was grounded, you know, it came before something where I had to give my car back. So I knew he was saying, your car is not moving for a moment. Be still. It's okay. So that was Friday night before last, week before last. And as I get to Monday morning, so this past Monday, I'm like, okay, I'm just going to walk to work. I live in home with work and home with, it's no big deal. I'm going to walk to work. And one other clue God gave me, he told me that my keys were closer than I thought they were. So I said, well, maybe it's near the porch. Maybe it's here. Maybe it's there. Well, I decided to walk to work. I think it was this last past Monday or Tuesday. And as I'm on my way to work, you guys, I see this sister on the corner. And I know some of the people in the neighborhood. And I just happened to stop and start talking to her. And we begin to talk, Pastor Brenda, Pastor Danny. We begin to just talk for a while. And as we're fellowshipping, and we're talking about life and what's going on and what we need and how can I pray for you and different things. As we begin to talk, I just happen to casually say, yeah, because I lost my keys a few days ago. And she said, you mean these keys right here?
Jesus.
What? And I was so stunned. I said, well, when'd you find them? She said, oh, about a half hour ago. My keys sat outside in the cell for 3 days.
Wow.
And when I stopped, when the Lord stopped me and allowed me to talk to this beautiful sister in the Lord.
Wow.
She found my keys.
Jesus.
Wow.
I give you praise, Lord. Yes. She found my keys. But see, I could have kept walking and been where I work, and I would have still, and see, but the Holy Spirit is good. He would have still allowed me to run into her later in the week. But the fact of the matter was, he said, no. See, I had to show you your keys were in the pocket of the one I wanted you to speak to. Because you need to be concerned about not the cares of this world, but about my cares,
Amen.
My business, my affairs, my people. And she blessed me so much.
Amen.
Because she didn't even know she was teaching me a lesson. She was teaching me such a lesson. I love that woman of God. She taught me such a lesson, and she knew the Lord, and we began to talk, and we got in the car, we rode together, and I said, you know what? I said, wow, I thought I was walking to work. But my key was in the pocket of the person I needed to talk to. And God set it up. God set it up. And it just blessed me because he was showing me. He told me a few things, you guys, about the cares of this world. But he said they're distractions that hinder my people from walking in what I have for them. They rob us from experiencing the fullness of what God has for us. The cares of this world, they cause us not to see the fulfillment of God's plan. And he said, I want my children to be faithful to their responsibilities, but the cares of this world are robbing them of experiencing. I mean, she blessed my day. I wanted to call you Pastor Brenda, but then eventually I felt like, okay, I'm going to hold this one. But I literally was leaving that encounter like, oh, I got to call Pastor Brenda. I got to call. But I had to get to work and had to shift it. But it was like I had to tell somebody what God had done. And I was like, God, I can't believe you did this. I can't believe you had these keys were outside for three. She only had them in her pocket for a half hour.
Jesus.